For probably.
You know, in some people.
It was okay.
My son-in-law is 35 degrees years old. He's been bald for 50 years. You know, so whatever.
I pushed it.
I used to have one of those.
Of course.
That was in the '70s, wasn't it?
And I pushed it. I just pushed it too far.
Irvin, now we can start your hair.
I would say.
Then you got your bodyguard with you.
We're all set.
How are you?
It's a good sign.
They must be paid off.
Morning, Chuck.
She's from the historic society. She's not on here.
Well, you know what? I really don't know.
Compared to what was coming.
I really can't tell.
That's a scary thought. This is really falling behind.
Yeah, well, we got to get rid of that clock. So the other room's up a little bit, yeah. It's only a minute behind every month.
It's true. But I'll wait till that clicks.
This is the one that you should be using, because that's what they're all using.
Yeah, that's a clock. That's right. These are rock.
That one, I would rather just throw it away, that clock.
You can do whatever you want.
Well, no, save it, but I might want to throw it.
Will it save it for you?
Save it for me to throw it.
Let's get it going here. We're in between.
Please stand with me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Good morning. I'd like to make one little announcement here. During the process, I do this every once in a while. During the process of the meeting, I'll ask for a motion and a second from the board. That does not mean that they're for or against it. That's just the procedure that we have here. So, moving on. Approval of county board minutes.
So moved, Mr. Chair. I'll second that, Mr. Chair.
I got a motion, a second. Any more discussion? Not. Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Deletions? Additions?
No, not this time.
Motion and second, please.
So moved.
Got a motion?
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. We have, let's move to our public hearing for the approval of the updated ordinance regulating the sale of tobacco and tobacco-related devices.
Good morning, Katie.
Good morning, Katie.
Mr. Chair, if Katie could just kind of briefly go through what we're considering this morning, what the changes are before we open it up for public comment.
Right.
You have to bear with me, my voice is leaving me again. So we're here to look at the ordinance regulating the sale of tobacco and tobacco-related devices in Morrison County. One of the reasons we looked at this, tobacco is still the leading cause of preventable death in Minnesota. The tools we have in our toolbox as a public health agency are those policy, system, and environmental health changes. And what you have in front of you is an updated version of the ordinance that was worked on with the Public Health Law Center and also refined from discussions at a planning session with the commissioners. The first item is updating the ordinance to reflect the updated Minnesota statute requirements, and those are licenses for e-cigarette sales, prohibition of e-cigarette sales to minors or from movable places of business, and child-resistant packaging for e-cigarette liquid. So as you can see, those are all around e-cigarette use. And then as our Morrison, Todd, and Wadena Community Health Board was considering these updates to reflect the new Minnesota statute, we also had some discussions about our tobacco prevention work within our grants. Our Community Health Board, which is chaired by Commissioner Johnson, committed to and invested in working on tobacco and other drugs through a few of our grants. The biggest being our SHIP grant, our Statewide Health Improvement Grant, where we have had this since 2009. And last year, the counties signed a commitment letter that committing to working on tobacco prevention work if awarded the SHIP grant, and also our drug-free communities grant, which focuses on alcohol, tobacco, and other drug prevention in all three counties. And all three counties are currently participating in that. To date, Todd and Wadena counties have passed strong ordinances regulating the sale of tobacco, being in our community health board. And so after discussing this ordinance at a planning session, the items for consideration from the commissioners that are in the ordinance currently are, so these are the changes I'm talking about. No licenses shall be issued to a movable place of business, and only fixed location businesses shall be eligible to be licensed under this ordinance. What's up on the screen right now, you are going to see some yellow. Those are just updated definitions and language. So nothing really that changes what it's saying, just different language. But what I'm talking about are the concrete changes. So that was the first one. The second one is smoking shall not be permitted, and no person shall smoke within the indoor area of any establishment licensed under this ordinance. Smoking for the purpose of sampling licensed products is prohibited. As we all know, we can't really smoke inside any establishments anymore. However, this really specifically addresses that sampling products, something that has become more common now with the e-cigarette juices and the e-cigarette, selling the e-cigarettes.
Mr. Chair, Katie, if I might interrupt you, are you aware of anywhere in Morrison County where today we have any of that sampling stuff like you're talking about?
I'm not aware of any of the sampling. There are places in Morrison County that sell the e-juice, but they sell it alongside the tobacco products. We don't have any specific store for e-juices or for e-cigarettes.
Okay. Very good.
But it is a common practice, and so something that we really don't want to see. The next one is by means of loosies. So loosies are a single individually packaged cigar or cigarette or any other licensed products it's been removed from its intended retail packaging and offered for sale. So it does not include those individual cigars with a retail price. So it's just those when you get it in a package and if they would take it out and sell it as individual. The next one is containing opium, morphine, ginseng weed, belladonna, strigonus, cocaine, marijuana, and other deleterious, hallucinogenic, toxic, and controlled substances, except nicotine and other substances found naturally in tobacco, or added as a part of an otherwise lawful manufacturing process. One of the reasons this is added is obviously it is illegal to put drugs within e-cigarette juices. However, if we don't have something in our ordinance that says, if you do this, then we're not going to give you a tobacco license. So they could potentially be in trouble with law enforcement. However, that doesn't really stop us in public health from giving them a tobacco license unless it's added into our ordinance. And then the last one is to sell, offer for sale, or otherwise distribute a package containing 5 or fewer cigars for sale for a sales price after any discounts are applied and before sales taxes are imposed of less than $2.10 per cigar contained within. In addition, no person shall sell, offer for sale, or otherwise distribute cigars in a package containing 6 or more cigars for a sale price after any discounts are applied and before sales taxes are imposed of less than $12.60 per package. This is so that they're not selling a package of 12 cigars for less than a package of 1 or 2. It makes it so that they're not kind of doing that wholesale thing and selling more for less money than you would get for individual ones. Sure. The thought process behind it being that we want to obviously see less tobacco products than more tobacco products. Are there any questions? Those are the changes that after planning session.
Mr. Chair, I'll move on this.
All right,
Mr. Chair, we're going to
have a public hearing.
Oh, excuse me, sorry.
But here's what we'll do is we'll be opening up the public for comment. I'll ask 3 times. If at that third time we don't have any with comment, then I'll, or comment, then what I'll do is close the hearing, and then we can do some discussion about this hereafter. Anybody who has any comment, please address the board. So that's all I ask. So at this time, it is 9:09. I'll open it up to the for public comment on the ordinance for regulating the sale of tobacco and tobacco-related devices. So again, I'll ask one for the first time. Anyone would like to stand up and state their name and for any comment? Second time, anyone want to stand up and state their name for any public comment?
I am a little confused. I was told we have no, you're just talking about your commissioners, not public, us.
You're the public. Please state up. Yeah, this is just on a tobacco issue. This is the issue. So,
well, okay. My name is Dennis Lubke. I live in Old Grove, which is close to, it's in Anoka County. And being very involved in my committee and so forth, you've probably seen on the news we have tremendous issues with drugs of all kinds. Cocaine in Anoka County is out of control. Having heard this, I'm glad to see that they're on it, because you state these laws and you start piecemealing them instead of just one blanket. And I know there's a lot of issues, but any effort we can do to start pushing back on any of the stuff like she's talking, we've got to do it, because the wheels turn slow. And we got gangs down there in the Twin Cities, and you got sanctuary cities. Worthington's a sanctuary city. Minneapolis, St. Paul. You got illegals coming in, you got drugs coming in, you got drug gangs getting to the point in the cities now. And you read your paper this morning, it's all about drugs, it's all about money. So I'm glad to see that Morrison County is actually getting involved in this.
Thank you. That was the second time I asked, so again, I'll ask for the second time if any more, anyone else has any more comment on this tobacco-related devices. And the third and final, anyone that would like to make a comment before I close the public on the tobacco-related devices? All right, we will close the public hearing at 9:11. All right, gentlemen, now I ask that we make a motion to approve the updated ordinance regulating the sale of tobacco and tobacco-related devices.
Mr. Chair? Again, I'll move on that.
All right, Commissioner Jelinski, I need a second.
I'll second.
Any discussion, gentlemen?
Mr. Chair, if I just want to get on record, we did not receive any written correspondence related to the public hearing. Thank you.
All right.
Mr. Chair?
Commissioner Maurer.
Regarding comments, the real concern I have with e-cigarettes is the vaping and the different kinds of things that can be used in that vapor. From cocaine to meth, a whole bunch of different things. So that's a concern, and I think this is something that needs to happen. It's so important that we address that issue that creates a window of opportunity for this kind of utilization. So I think it's very important. So thank you.
Any more discussion, Joe?
Commissioner Wilson. You said six places. Do we only have six places? Did you say that, or did I misunderstand something?
You maybe misunderstood me because of my cold.
Yep. Okay, well, that's possible. Because I was going to say there's more than six places, I think, that sell tobacco, right?
Yep, yes. Mr. Chair, keep in mind that this is the outside of city limits that would have their own regulations.
That was my next question, that this doesn't pertain to too many places, probably some bars and stuff.
30, almost 40 places.
Oh, really?
Do we regulate all tobacco sales within the county?
Nope. But that's how many are outside of the Little Falls jurisdiction.
Yeah. Yeah, people don't realize that, Board Chair, there is that a lot of places other than just within the city, not just the city of Little Falls. You've got Upsala, Royalton, they're not part of this.
They're not part of Little Falls.
Right.
And this kind of came about from e-cigarettes saying that it's not a cigarette, and that's kind of what brought this all about, right?
This came about from changes in Minnesota statute. So we were going to change our ordinance to reflect the changes in Minnesota statute. Yep. And so we looked at it more broadly.
And Katie, you said Wadena and Todd County have approved it already.
Correct. In our community health board, which is Morrison, Todd, Wadena, they have passed
Okay.
actually stricter than this even tobacco ordinances.
Okay.
Any more discussion, gentlemen? If not, I have a motion and a second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you, Commissioner. I have a few other things, just some environmental health stuff. First of all, I'm going to be asking for a few licenses for the Tootell Tavern, but Deb Lau also has a license. Would you like to do those all at once for the same establishment or keep them separate?
I'm assuming we can do them all the same ones, yeah.
Okay, so Deb, if you want to. So for public health, I have to approve the 2016 new owner establishment license for the Tootell Tavern. This was formerly known as the Hitching Rail. And like I said, new owner.
And we basically need to transfer the off sale and the Sunday license from the old owner to the new owner.
So moved.
Second.
We were going to put both of them together, correct?
And I also have to approve their tobacco licensing. So new establishment, tobacco licensing, and then for
liquor licenses.
So I need a motion, gentlemen, from the Tootell Tavern for the liquor license and for the tobacco license at this time.
Second.
And the new establishment.
And the new establishment. Oh, as a new establishment.
As well, get it all.
Get it all in there. Okay, I got a motion and a second. You got a.
You got it all? Yep, I think so.
Yeah, we have, I have Kevin and Dwayne.
Very good. All right, any more discussion?
Mr. Chair, it was a transfer of the liquor license, correct?
Correct.
Yes.
Okay.
Any more discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Great, and then I have, thank you, Deb.
We'll see you again then.
Yep.
I have one more. This is the Tall Pines Retreats. So this is something that had come to the board before back in December from planning and zoning, and they did have an interim use permit. So there was some stipulations the board had put on that interim use permit. So in order to work together with public health and planning and zoning, we did talk to the owner, and we will be accompanying, if approved, if their new establishment license, excuse me, is approved, we will be sending a letter with it. We did talk to Brian Mittendorf too, to make sure that the owner knows that whatever license they're under that is more strict is what they have to follow. So they'll be getting a letter saying, because for public health, they can actually, they have 12 beds, but they can only have 8 people there at one time. And so we did talk to the owner and clarified that all for the owner.
The conditions in the interim use permit are more restrictive than what it would be for a typical lodging license for the public health, and that more restrictive condition applies. And so just clarifying that information for them.
Gentlemen, for discussion, I need a motion to approve the 2016 new establishment license for Tall Pines Retreats.
So moved.
I have a motion. I need a second.
Second.
I got a second. Any discussion?
Mr. Chair, I'm not clear. What does this mean? I got it. It's a new establishment. I understand that. But we're giving them a license to do what?
For lodging, Mr. Chair.
Just
so they can
simply staying overnight.
Yep.
And Mr. Chair, this was approved at our previous request. This is just differentiating between the 12 and the 8. They already were.
They were approved for the planning and zoning requirements.
Right. There you go. Okay, right. So.
And if I may, too, the restrictions on the interim use permit are.
So instead of, they can have 8 people there at any one time for a retreat. The retreats cannot be held on holiday weekends.
Right.
I think it's Memorial, 4th of July.
Right.
And,
and
they can only have, I think it's 6 events per year.
This was our painter we were talking about.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
No, I thought
this is the artist.
Yes.
The
artist.
Okay.
Any more discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you,
Katie. Thank you.
Get
Rich
well,
Prairie.
Get well soon.
Thanks.
Morning, guys.
Come on up, gentlemen.
Morning.
Oh, they're both hot herb.
They are, huh?
State your name for the record, please.
Chuck Starkamp, Rich Prairie Sewer and Water.
Herb Versosky, Rich Prairie Sewer and Water.
Good morning.
And what brings us here today is the same as the last few years. Just going over our financial, answering any questions you may have about our operation. because you guys are authority over us, and we can bring you up to date on things that are happening.
You're not just coming to say hi.
Well,
no. It's a, give you an annual report, but I did bring a book in for Deb, and I don't know if she shared it with any of you, if any of you had a chance to read it.
In my office for review, and it'll continue to be there on their request. They can take turns taking it home. Any, what's been going on? What is, how's the year gone?
Everything's going quite good. We've got a fair amount in reserve right now, a little over $1 million. We do have some upcoming expenses that we're trying to anticipate for. One will be painting the water tower. It's going on 18 years now. And we had it inspected this last year, and they're seeing some rust and maintenance that needs to be done, which would be sandblast inside and out and recoating it. We're looking at probably over $400,000 on that. And today's price, now 5 years from now, it might be more. So that's one of the items.
We tentatively got it scheduled for 2021 to do that project. So.
Do the water tower?
Yes.
Because there's a road project too, right?
Yes, we're doing the north end in 2020. Actually, we've got an agreement signed with the county and the city of Pierce.
Mr. Chair, Herbert, Chuck, I wonder if you can give a little bit of background, really. What brings you actually here? The Rich Prairie Sewer and Water District, I got that, I understand it, but what really brings you here?
Your board is our overseers. Okay. We actually have to answer, if we need to refinance or anything, we need to come to you and you need to sign off on any.
Right, we cannot even go borrow money unless it's through your board here.
So a long, long time ago when this was put together.
Yes.
Did the county kind of sign the note?
Yes.
The if you default on it, the county pays?
When the district was set up, it was set up with the agreement that the county board would be our oversight. And starting out, they never really got involved, and for a period of time, as the boards change, your board changes, our board changes, people tend to forget. So we decided every year we would come and give you an update and keep everybody in the loop.
Commissioner Johnson, you've been involved with us 8 or 10 years now, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I remember the first one.
I've been on the board since 98 when it started. In fact, Mike was one of the people that helped set this up. Mm-hmm. Originally, we could have gone with a joint powers agreement with Tuckman, Piers, and Genola.
Yeah.
But the process is so slow to get everything through each meeting to make any decisions. And they said a separate district would be better, but to do a separate district, you have to go through a county. Okay. So, and that's how you guys got involved. Originally, our money was not borrowed through here, it was through USDA. And we rewrote the loan and come to you, and you helped us get funding for that. It was $10.5 million project, and we had over $4 million grant money. So there was $6 million loan out there. And so far, where are we paid down on that?
We're down to about 3.7 right now, 3.8.
And that's since
originally, we were structured, we were going to be paid off in 2040, but when we restructured our loan, we're down to 2033 now. So.
Okay. And this whole entire event started, I believe, Chuck, I think you just said, was 1998?
98.
That's when this was all put together.
Yes.
And we started up the water and sewer district. We run out of money. We started up about a couple $100,000 in the red. And we had no more money available. So since that time, we've worked ourselves to the position that we're at now.
Yeah. Wonderful.
We haven't had to come to anybody, including yourselves, for money in our 16 years. Or 18 years here.
Well, gentlemen, you stated you have like a general fund. How much did you have in that?
We have about $1.4 million right now as of to date, but we're going to be turning in a couple $100,000 to you before the end of the year to make our second payment. So we'll be back at about $1.2 million at the end of the year.
But you still have a little nest egg there.
In 2020, when we do the north end, we're looking at probably $400,000 even after assessments. So that's going to be a big undertaking. And then in 2021, we want to do the water tower, which is going to be over 400. So,
so Mr. Chair, you're planning ahead and saving up.
Well, yeah, at least, you know, the last thing we wanna do is come to you and say, hey, we need to go borrow money.
But that's what you have that fund for there too, so you can do this project.
Like last year, we had our wells, had the pumps pulled and inspected. And in that process, we found one of our wells had a hole in the casing. The state of Minnesota will not let you dig down and repair, you put in a new well. So we got hit with right around $70,000 expense that was unexpected. So we inspected, well, we did that well last year, new casing, new drilling, everything. And rather than do them both, we decided in case we hit another bad one, we had the other one done this last year and that one during the spring, I think. And that one got a new pump upgraded, so now we should be good for 20 years on our wells.
Mr. Chair, that was kind of a unique project back at that time because we hooked three towns together. And Fish Lake would have possibly been in there if it would have came a little earlier.
Yes.
But the grant and everything was already approved and we'd have had to start the process all over again. But you guys have done a wonderful job on that. And I think our rates are about $70 a month for water.
80, right.
Is it 80?
Yeah.
For water and sewer. And you know, when people talk about our septic systems costing them $10,000 for this and that, you know, we pay that every month so that we don't have those problems and the repairs and stuff stay up, and you guys have been doing a wonderful job with all that stuff, so.
Yeah, from day one, looking back, hindsight, there was never an assessment made up front, so nobody paid a cent up front. So it's all done on a monthly basis, and they felt for the older people in town, it was easier for them to make a monthly payment than to get a big assessment up front, so.
Yeah, had we done a $5,000 or say even $10,000 assessment per household, we would have a lot less debt right now, but it would
kind of. Commissioner Mauer.
Mr. Chair, and going back a little ways, Chuck and I go way back, and I grew up in the city of Piers pretty much. My grandparents lived there, and I fished the Skunk River back in the day. And, you know, this isn't just about the project that you did, but really how environmentally responsible this has become. Being the chairman of the Headwaters, Mississippi Headwaters Board, we really can only help out cities that are MS4 cities that are 5,000 or more. But we are starting to look at how do we help the cities out beyond that to really address some of these issues. You have done this, whereas the water that you did when you did your process ended up back in the Skunk River. Now you have a retention pond. A lot of that's taken care of by evaporation. A lot of that stuff is not dumped into the Skunk River anymore. So this is very good, important stuff, not just from helping the people and dealing with these issues, but from an environmental standpoint. So, you know, great stuff that you have done, and it's very, very environmentally conscious as well. So I just wanted to mention that aspect of it as well, because that's so helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah, the old system, that's right, it went into the Skunk River, and the state was on them pretty steady. I mean, they were ready to shut them down completely. And back then, one of the issues was that there was no money set aside for upgrades on anything. There was, Piers had no money in a fund for the system. So.
Yeah. So is it, Mr. Chair, if I may, is it the city of Buckman, the city of Genola?
Yes.
And Pierce. So every resident business in those three cities is hooked up.
Right.
Okay. Except Buckman has their own water, which they had before.
Okay. 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 Very good.
So we just service Buckman with waste sewer.
Yes.
The sewer part of it.
And with going with three cities back at that time, Pierce was going to do this on their own. And they realized the funding would be much better if you include more cities.
Oh, I'm sure.
So by us going in and then lower median household income got them more grant money. When we first started the process, it was going to be like an 80% grant, but then they ran out of money. It rolled into another year. In that process, they changed their funding.
Sure.
So we all ended up with about 40% grant.
And at the same time, then there was some annexation done down by from the park in the city to the south. That whole area was annexed, and then over on 27, that was all annexed.
Sure,
to
sure,
the city,
yeah.
So.
Sure. Yeah.
And that brought up issues too, because some of those people just built new homes and put in septic systems and water systems, so they had to abandon those.
Yeah.
So, you know, with every project, there's winners and losers, and that's just how it works, but that was the right thing to do back then.
If I can, again, I grew up in that area too. Buckman, when did they put up their water tower? That was back in the 80s?
Oh, their new one, they used to have that old one.
They had water for years.
See, I can't, I thought all of a sudden, I just, where'd they get their water from? I mean, maybe as a kid, I'd never seen a water tower.
Yeah, the new one was put up in the '80s.
Yeah, seventies, I think, might even been. I just remember.
They've had water probably since the '60s.
Oh, okay.
Long time.
You know, this is such a good example of local governments working together to address issues that need to be addressed, so thanks for all your work, guys.
Anything else, gentlemen?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate you stopping.
I wanna thank the board too with the funding you've helped us out with over the years here.
You can come back more than once a year.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, why not?
Right here.
Just raise, you can, can't you just raise his?
Irving, don't raise our rates.
Just raise yours.
We're trying to hold it for a couple of years now. We did last year with, because of looking ahead what we were seeing with the tower and with the road and.
You know, it's always good to plan ahead. These expenses are gonna happen. Things are built for 20, 30 years, and I think some of our water pipes are probably 50 years.
Some of the main waters in the thirties.
So I mean, it's just good that you guys are doing a good job.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Great.
Appreciate it, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, guys. Have a good day.
Carol, community development, please.
Good morning, Carol.
Morning, Carol.
Even though we know who you are, Carol, please state your name for the record and all that.
Carol Anderson, from Community Development of Morrison County. Good things are happening in Piers, as you just heard, and if you drove in there, you see that the old bank restaurant is gone in that house, and I mean, it just opened up the town, and of course, Essentia Health is gonna be putting up that new clinic, and Community Development gave the city of Piers a grant for $10,000 to from our pollution cleanup fund to remove all the asbestos out of the old bank in that house. So that's all been approved, and I've got all the documentation. I just need a copy of a check that the city paid, and we'll reimburse them for that.
And Mr. Chair, I think my mother-in-law has finally stopped crying. She was a little sad. She worked hard in all that business for a long time, but recognizes the good it's done for the
She may really like the new building when it goes
so.
Up.
I
yeah,
think
I mean,
so.
I mean, to have a nice new clinic in Piers is really an addition to the community.
Very
nice. Yep, and Starry-Eyed Brewing, we closed on that loan a couple of months ago. It was right after I was here, and so they're hoping to be opening with their tasting room by the end of the year.
And if I may, that's the one next to the ethanol, right?
FSA office, the Little Falls Repairable building on the south side,
right.
That's where they're going. They have the whole building.
Oh, they have the whole building.
They have the whole building, and they will be having their larger brewery in the back, and then they have the land to the south of the building, and that's where people come, and they can be playing board games or sitting outside and enjoying, you know, one of their brews. But they're going to plant some hops right around the perimeter of that and grow their own hops as well, so people can see that growing. And they are going to try working with some of the local restaurants. If they want to come, say, Thursday night, you know, maybe the Black and White, you know, you can order certain things off their menu. Domino's, so they want to work with our local restaurants, you know, to provide the food that they don't want to do. Or they can have food trucks may come in too. So I think it's going to be a fun place, and it's a good location for it as well. And there are two local guys that are doing it, and I'm really very pleased to help them. You're going to be getting an invitation in the next week or so. I was working with Bob Reinitz last night on the Camp Ripley Veterans State Trail. Are going to have a ride, if you haven't heard about it, October 7th at 1:30 in the afternoon, leaving from the Fort Steakhouse. And it's, you know, he's going to be getting some of the local ATV dealers can have displays. Some may even provide, if you don't have an ATV, that you can use one to go ride the trail and see what it's like. So that's October 7th, so watch your mailboxes for the invitation. It should be coming. And I've also been working Region 5 with a grant from NJPA is in the process of doing a branding for our 5-county region here. And so working with them on their committees on, you know, how are we going to brand this? And then they in turn are going to work with Golden Shovel, and that'll be part of the regional website. And we're hoping to not only attract tourism, but to attract younger people that would like to come to the area and work, that they can see what we have available here in all of our communities. So that's kind of it for now.
And you got some big businesses coming in that you're just...
not that I can say right now.
Okay. Well, you got the big addition in Lund. Right.
Yes, yes. And now the next, you know, portion that we've got to start working with, and we have been, but Lund has been so busy with getting the building. They need workers. They need welders. And how are we going to get them? And we want to bring that welding trailer back and work with some of the school districts, you know, to get some of the kids in there. The other thing the MnState system can do out of Detroit Lakes is they can bring their instructor in and work with the instructors in the school districts, so that when a kid gets done and they graduate from high school, they already have a welding certificate. So they could go straight and get a job and not have to, you know, pay all the tuition, you know, for a year or two to get the training. So we would really like to get that going too, so.
Mr. Chair, it's kind of unique how this has come full circle, isn't it? From taking that stuff out of the schools and now the need to put it back. It's just, it just is amazing to me. So that's good stuff.
And the other thing we work with through Rural Minnesota SEP and the Workforce Council is we've got, and we're lucky, we've got career counselors in about 15 school districts, and it's real heavy in this area. I think we have career counselors in all the schools here, even if they come in for 1 or 2 days a week to work with kids. What would you like to do? What are your aptitudes? Where would you go? How much is this job going to pay you when you get done? What kind of debt are you going to have? And then they help them apply and fill out the paperwork. So and counselors have enough to do in the schools already, but we can bring those career counselors in to help them. How do you do a resume? How do you do a job search?
Out of SEP, you do that?
Yes, we do that. We have career counselors in all the school districts here in the county, and then some.
Mr. Chair, I think that's real important, too, that you really take kids and you try to find out what they want to do and get them on the right path. I think school sometimes, it gets lost in what they do every day.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. But this career thing, and we're really missing the labor. You know, building welders,
yep.
Just the everyday work that's hard to find people, and they pay very good now.
Yep.
So
you do.
Not everybody's for college.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah, and that's absolutely right. And that's what Rural Minnesota SEP has really done, and we've pieced together the funding through grants from the Initiative Foundation, Blandin Foundation, Otto Bremer Foundation, and we've put all that money together to pay for these counselors, and now the school districts have seen the value in it, and they're contributing some funds to maybe pay for 1 day a week. I know Little Falls, because of the, they have the largest population of students. I think we have a career counselor there every day. So.
Yeah. Very good.
Yes.
Anything
else?
Thank you, Carol.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Very much, Carol.
Have a good day.
Okay. I guess we'll bring up Deb for the discussion of the approval of the order for Lake Shamana.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Morning. Good morning, Deb.
Good morning, Deb.
So you can go ahead and explain what you're all about.
Lake Shamana Lake Improvement District came to us this spring and asked us to change the levee structure for the Lake Improvement District. Basically, we wanted to make the distribution a little bit more fair across the residents and the commercial districts. And so we're changing the levy structure after holding a public hearing and getting public comment to place the levy assessment on one levy per parcel instead of one levy per owner, and a 35% assessment per commercial unit in addition to the per parcel. So that increases the commercial commitment, commercial assessments, and evens out the residential input a little bit. And based on the public comment, it seemed like we had a pretty interested public. Everybody seemed to be on board for this levy structure.
I guess, go ahead.
If I could just recap, on August 23rd, we had that public hearing. It was 7 p.m. You all were there. It was a great turnout. It's always good to see people interested and participate in this process that is designed for public participation. And so we had almost a packed boardroom, which was great to see. You heard all of the comments. We had a significant amount of comments also submitted in writing that we entered into record, and are here as a result of that public hearing through that process, and now for your consideration to change that levy structure according to the wishes of that board, or well, the discussions that came about from many meetings, I should say, between you and the Lake Improvement District Board. So,
gentlemen, I'm going to ask for a motion and a second to discuss the order of the Lake Chaminade Lake Improvement. I need a motion, gentlemen.
I'll make a motion.
Commissioner Wilson, I need a second.
Second.
Now we can discuss a little bit more. I know I have some questions. The dollar amount that's going to be generated by this 35% increase, do we have that?
Based on the current budget that was approved at the Lake Chaminade annual meeting, their budget would be $27,000 approximately for this next year, and you have not seen that yet, which means the assessment per parcel would go up to $61, which would increase the commercial a little bit. But based on what we were estimating at $20,000 budget, the residential units would have been about $12. So on the $27,000 budget, it's going to go up to about $13 or so.
Mr. Chair,
you said residential. You mean commercial?
Commercial units. Commercial units, sorry.
Yeah. Okay, I just
watch my wording, yes,
yeah,
please.
So the decision here is about how that pie is split, not the size of the pie, so to speak. This
right.
is about when you set a levy, when you set that budget, which you will do, I believe, actually next board meeting, Bob's coming, or the Lake Improvement District's coming for that budget. That's
okay.
a separate issue.
Okay.
It's not about the size that you're generating.
It's about how it's going to be split.
Mr. Chair, and as far as further discussion, at the public hearing, there were a few people that were not supportive of this, but the majority of the people were. And at the Lake Owners Association meeting and the Lake Improvement District meeting a couple of weeks ago, there was unanimous support of the people that were there regarding this format that's being presented today. I just wanted to mention that.
And if I may also, next year, again, the percentage stays the same unless we have another public, but we could also, if the LID comes back, Lake Improvement District comes back, and they don't need as much money, then we as a board can reduce that for the cost. Am I correct on that?
They will propose their budget to us again. They will bring their budget to us every year.
Well, and Mr. Chair, the unique part of this process that I explained at the Lakeland Association meeting is that, first of all, the lake property owners that are involved in this elect the president and the members of the Lake Improvement District, okay? Then it goes to their meeting, and they then, of course, agree and approve that budget, okay? Then it comes to the county board for their input and approval or denial. So this process has a number of stages and steps that have to be gone through to change the amount.
Correct.
This is just setting up the format by which it's billed, but that amount annually has to come through those boards and then come to the county board. So there's a real check and balance system in numerous places before it gets to increasing that. People were very concerned about that going up, because I believe Lake Alec is at $200 per parcel.
Right.
Okay, so that was a big concern. So we ultimately will decide on that at the last part of this.
Commissioner Johnson.
Yeah. Well, I think Kevin just brought mine up. The resort owners kind of were, you know, it's low now, but what if it goes to $200, for instance?
Right.
That's what they were worried about, but we said it's got to come back here, so.
Yep. And we want to keep it as low as we can, obviously, but we want to take care of the water too. And so that's something you have to look at every year when that budget comes before you.
And I know the answer to this, but I'll ask it again. Who's in charge of this money once they receive it?
The Lake Improvement District Board.
And so we can't tell them to use it for invasive waters. They're the ones that are responsible to how they distribute the money, correct?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, they're responsible for distributing it, using the money, but they also get audited every 5 years by the state auditor, just like we do.
And they report to us on an annual basis what their plan is.
Mr. Chair, and not just that, okay? They had to provide the county board with a plan that says under what premise that money can be used for.
And if they don't follow that plan, they're going to get written up, and then the DNR is going to come down on them, and we're going to come down on them, and the state auditor's going to come down on them.
And we haven't had that issue, so that's...
No, we haven't.
Mr. Chair, couple of things. Per partial, there's property out there that one cabin is two partials.
Yes.
Right? Three partials, maybe four. So that's land. 35% on commercial. Commercial, are we talking, I know we're talking resorts. What if you had a bar on the lake? Is that, or is there none out there?
I don't believe there are any out there. There's like, the one has a restaurant.
Has a liquor license, but...
But they don't rent any units.
But when you said commercial...
Right.
Is that, do they pay the partial one, or...
They pay a per parcel, but they don't rent any units, so there are no per rental.
Okay. And this budget was a little higher, if I'm not mistaken, in our discussion, because last year, with the budget they had, a bunch of people opted out by some method. And so that runover from last year to this year was probably $6,000, am I right?
That's part of it, yep.
You know, so that was added on to this year's budget because they were short that last year.
Correct.
Because of the way it went. So this would not have gone up so much if it was followed last year.
Yeah, that's part of it, yep.
Yep, so, okay.
So Mr. Chair, might I ask, under number two, if you will, it says the levy structure will be one assessment per parcel. I'm trying to frame that in my mind. One assessment per parcel.
Mm-hmm.
So one assessment per parcel plus an additional assessment of 35% for each commercial unit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right here. So it's 35% of this?
Yeah.
No. Per rental units. So they have, in addition to a parcel of property, that a commercial property that has rental units, that is a parcel. They may have a number of them. But then the idea is that if you have rental units, you also have other people visiting and utilizing the lake.
Yep.
And so the idea was to take a look at the rental units, which we have on file in the assessor's office, and we have a database that houses that it's based on also 35% per rental unit or per group of them.
Mr. Chair, so if you have like six RVs that you camp there or park there throughout the year and you rent those out, each of those is a rental unit, and each of those would pay 35% of a normal assessment.
Gotcha.
And if I may, how difficult is this to use the word police? If do we have records to show how many units they have on each of these?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, our assessor goes out once a year and gets that information as part of his assessment process, and we plan to use that information.
So the information we're already gathering, based upon a requirement that we have for appraising property, we can now utilize in another office for this, for accommodating this process of being able to assess properly. So it's brilliant.
So Jeff, back to your, when you described it like this, they're going to pay this
plus
35% of this.
Yep.
Correct.
Yep.
He used the cell phone.
But that was good. Yep.
Hey, great discussion, gentlemen. Any more? All right, so I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Deb.
Yeah. Thank you, Deb.
Thank you, Deb.
Sheriff's report.
Thanks, Bob.
Morning, Sheriff.
Morning, Sean.
Morning. Morning, Sheriff.
Morning.
Well, today, I'm just here to do a, I guess it would be a resolution for a TZD grant. TZD stands for Toward Zero Deaths. So I just need a signature from the chair and from the commissioner. So just to go over TZD a little bit, basically, this is an annual event where we come every year and we get federal funding. This year, we're going to get $13,050. I'm sorry, $13,050. It's going to start October 1st, 2016, and it's going to run through September 30th of 2017. Basically, we applied for it. We were granted that amount. TZD covers extra enforcement. Our focus is on seat belts, distracted driving, speed, the move over law. So when there's an officer initiating a traffic stop, everyone's supposed to move over to the other lane if there's another lane to move over to. We also focus on DUI enforcement. So in order for the grant to be implemented, we have to have this resolution signed. Any questions for me at all?
Gentlemen, I'll ask for a motion and a second towards zero death federally funded overtime grant.
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any more discussion?
Well, Mr. Chair, and so these dollars are spent how? For salaries? For, I mean, can you kind of explain how that breakdown is, Sean?
Yep. It's actually all overtime shifts. It's okay. Extra shifts above and beyond what our deputies are scheduled for. Also included, so we're going to have Morrison County Sheriff's Office participating. We're also going to have the small town police departments as well participate.
Meaning? This,
so we're going to have Little Falls Police, Piers, Motley, Royalton. Okay. Randall does not partake in this.
Okay.
The rest do. State Patrol, they have their own grant, but we'll also be working with them and coordinating our efforts with them for extra patrol as well. So what it is we focus on the high traffic areas. So if Morrison County, let's just pick a weekend, let's just say, well, it's already passed, but let's say Labor Day weekend. We know there's gonna be a lot of traffic. So we'll work with the Little Falls PD, we'll work with Motley PD, and that's why you may see a Motley car, you know, maybe down in Little Falls, depending on where we plan on focusing our efforts. We all work together. Mm-hmm. And again, that's what we're focusing on, is those things that were listed before.
Well, and Mr. Chair, a question I have regarding that, you said Randall doesn't participate, yet Highway 10 goes right through Randall, and then one, which is a very busy county state 8 highway, goes through Randall.
The reasoning for that is you have a chief that's part-time there.
Oh, okay.
So all our guys are getting their 40 hours a week. This is all overtime funding that's available.
I see.
Yep.
Okay. Just wondering.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair, if I may. Sheriff, we're all very clear that Highway 10, 370, 125, whatever, are our high traffic roads. I'm anticipating we're not just talking about those roads. We are talking about the county road ones of the world, the 23s, the whatever.
Correct.
Pick a number. We're not just picking on, maybe you can expand on that.
Yep, absolutely. Like that. So what we do is we try and find if there's different events taking place as well. Maybe there's a city that's going to be impacted the weekend we work. But we do want the high visible traffic. So a lot of times it is going to be the highways, but there are times where we may take the whole group of law enforcement personnel and just focus on a city itself.
Well, Mr. Chair, and this doesn't include the Highway Patrol. That's something separate, no. Correct?
Correct. Well, the State Patrol has their own grant, but we will coordinate sometimes our weekends together.
But the dollars are just for local?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. And because Morrison County is the lead agency in charge, that's why the funding needs to come through us.
Okay. Yep. Thank you.
Yep.
Gentlemen, any more discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
And that's all I have, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. I see Brad out there somewhere. There he is.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, Commissioners.
Good morning, Brad.
Today I asked Penny to put together a report on chemical dependency services, and she is at a training today, so I maintain that in the packet. And so what you have in front of you is some information on chemical dependency services in Morrison County. Basically, it's the chemical use assessments that we do, and we get them in a couple of different ways. Number one, if an individual does a criminal offense and alcohol or chemicals are involved, through driving while intoxicated, we would be doing the chemical use assessment. There's also individuals that come through on a voluntary basis trying to get into treatment because of their chemical use. We are also members of the Morrison County Drug Court, as well as a prescription drug task force. So the first graph you have is the number of assessments that have been done by. We have currently one full-time equivalent and about a 2.2 equivalent that does chemical dependency assessments. So as you can see, we have increased our chemical use assessments for 2016. They are on the rise on an overall basis. When you talk about the next graph, which is chemical dependency case management cases, when somebody enters treatment and they qualify for consolidated funding, we maintain their open case and continue to pay for their treatment. So that this is the only service that does not have a funding stream to provide case management services to when it comes to chemical dependency individuals. This has been a hot topic of information or a hot topic for discussion across the state over the last few years, especially as you talk about the homeless population, the drug courts and specialty courts that have been created. But they're really the only population that struggles with some day-to-day activities that does not have access to chemical dependent or case management services. The third slide is on detoxification. So what I've actually done here is created a graph that shows from 2010 through 2016. Detox, as it's called, is a solely county-funded service. There is no reimbursement. Well, I shouldn't say that. There is a little bit of insurance coverage, and then we do assess some fees for those that have a certain level of income. But this is strictly tax levy dollars that pays for detoxification. The reason I went back to 2010 is somewhere around, I believe it was July of 2011, the Crow Wing County Detox Center closed. And as you can see, it was a significant decrease from there. It slowly began to increase again, and now is somewhat leveled off. You'll see in our budget presentation this afternoon how much we have budgeted for that line item. And then the line at the bottom is not a very good graph, but however, it just shows that's the number of individuals. It could be individuals who've been there more than once. It could be somebody that's been there one day or 3 days, but those are the number of occurrences. And our current detox cost is $445 per day. Our primary detox center that we use is out of St. Cloud, Central Minnesota Mental Health Center. We're not a member of that mental health center, so we do pay a higher share of the per diem costs than those counties who are members, which is Benton, Stearns, and Sherburne, I believe. And I believe they get like a $20 per day discount or $10 or $20 discount. I cannot remember exactly what they are getting in terms of the discount. Some of the trends that we are seeing in 2016, as I indicated, the assessments and cases are up. We have had Drug Corps, which has been established since 2014. We've had 4 graduations and currently have 17 participants. I know we talked a little bit about that last week. Again, that is, I'm sure the Drug Corps will be coming forth shortly to talk more about the services they provide. But it is a specialty court that provides a quality service, and I think statistically it shows some good results for some very high-level users of chemicals. And so we're proud to be a member of the drug court and a partner in the drug court process. We've also had some conversation around pregnant women who are coming through the system now and are struggling in terms of ending their chemical use. And so we've had a few more coming through both the chemical dependency system and the child welfare system. A lot of times we have to talk with the county attorney's office about commitment of these individuals if they're not willing to either go in voluntarily or commit to ending their substance use. And with the new child protection statutes, this is now a requirement that we have to intervene when we receive a report on a pregnant woman who is using chemicals. So we're also, as I said, a member of the Prescription Drug Task Force. And the hospital has began to create a Suboxone clinic, which is a medically assisted treatment program for those individuals who are addicted to prescription drugs. And then just one of the other reasons that I brought this forward, and this again will come up at our budget meeting this afternoon, is that I was a member of the legislative or the stakeholder work group at the Department of Human Services this past year, and they are looking to try and create a direct access system of care for those who are substance abusers. And in theory, it sounds very well. However, there are a couple challenges, and that is number one, client access to treatment. So they would like to make chemical dependency a medical service similar to every other healthcare process that we go through. Somebody breaks a leg, they get into the emergency room, they go get their leg fixed, they come out. I'm a diabetic, I get into the doctor, I get the treatment I need. With chemical dependency, it's a more challenging because number one, there are not the providers available. So we are anywhere from 1 to 4 weeks out in terms of finding a suitable treatment program for individuals with a substance use disorder. So in using the analogy of if I break my leg, let's say I tore my ACL, I get into the emergency room, I get, you know, signed up with a, I could maybe do my orthopedic surgeon appointment in the same week, maybe not. Most likely I can if you're Adrian Peterson or Teddy Bridgewater, you're going to get in the same week, but for chemical dependency, if somebody shows up in an emergency room with a chemical dependency issue, as I said, they're not going to get into treatment for 1 to 3 weeks. So it's not going to be a direct access type of medical service that I think the state is thinking that it will be. The other challenge is that currently counties pay 20% of all treatment costs for individuals who qualify for the consolidated fund. So part of this direct access is on the county's checkbook. And so we've been pretty firm with the fact that if the county has a checkbook involved, we would like to have some say in eligibility determinations and ensuring appropriate access to treatment.
Mr. Chair, and how that can be a problem is if somebody outside of the county system decides where a person's going to go and at what level of care, they could send them to a long-term inpatient program, which would be very, very excessive costly, so we wouldn't be able to control those dollars.
Yeah. And so as you talk about changing the chemical dependency system, the treatment system, there are some challenges. And I think the biggest part of that is that currently the state uses the federal match for some treatment dollars as the federal match for those dollars. So that 20% the state needs, or they would have to, again, match those federal dollars through their own checkbook. So that's what I have today in terms of chemical dependency services. I don't know if there's other questions or...
Mr. Chair, I do have a question. Deb, I wonder if you can bring the graph just down a little bit that you have right there. Brad, I'm very aware of what detoxification means. And detox as I would know it. And as you started the conversation, if I'm reading it right, I just want to know if I am. In 2010, Morrison County spent rough numbers here, $106,000 on detoxification. I don't care where they went.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm looking at this graph and I'm seeing a drastic decline right about 2011, 2012, went right down to half. What does that mean? Does it mean that law enforcement, social workers, public health, whomever, in 2010 had this group of individuals that were in detox, and then about 2011-ish, 2012-ish, those people just vanished? Or they just didn't appear at your facility and went right downhill to 50%? And then we all of a sudden started gradually going up again, leveling off a little bit between 14 and 15, and of course we're down, going right back down again.
Well, we'll be almost done budget for this year, so that's
and it is, I'm very clear. It's a half a year, so we would be in the 63,000 rough numbers according to that 66 whatever. But what happened there? People did not stop boozing. I'm sorry.
Build it and they will come. Okay. I think is a good analogy. It is interesting, you know, we were in a unique situation here in Morrison County. We had a detox facility in Crow Wing County.
Yep.
We have a detox facility in St. Cloud.
Yep.
one of the things that the detox facility in Brainerd did would come pick up those individuals and bring them back, so we would end up paying for that person's stay. Once they closed, law enforcement did not have that direct service. And so it's really actually a credit to law enforcement that they have done a better job of managing that population that they had run into in previous years, where they would just call up the detox center in Brainerd and they would come pick them up. Now they're talking with family, friends, neighbors to assist in caring for them. And it does bring bring that philosophical question about, was that the right move? Is that the right philosophy to have? And I think it's still debatable today. However, we don't want to take law enforcement off the streets to have them be driving to Pine Manor, which is up by Wadena, or down to Dakota Receiving, which is in Hastings, because that's not fair to the other residents of Morrison County. So they've done a good job of finding other means by which to support those individuals that they had run into previously. So that's really what happened. I think it's a philosophical conversation about how, what's the best way to go. But just one last comment. Again, detox is solely county funded, and detox centers across the state have dwindled. I believe there's 10, only like 10 or 11 left. And part of the challenge is just around the licensing of chemical dependency treatment programs, and then how detox centers have to be licensed. People are not willing to commit that level of funding to those centers to care for those individuals.
Mr. Chair, and if I may, as I can speak from a little bit of experience, since I was the senior counselor at Dakota County or Crow Wing County Detox for 6 years, and then a nurse as well, and worked in both capacities there. You know, there's another part of this story that Brad isn't mentioning, okay? We have a really difficult time now finding placement for mentally ill clients who are also chemically dependent. And the real good thing about Crow Wing County Detox is we were one of the only detoxes in the state that took care of and held people in lieu of their commitment process when they had mental illness and chemical dependency issues, or opiate dependent and methamphetamine dependent individuals, where most places wouldn't take them. A lot of those people are now ending up in our jails and in our prisons. So we've seen the backlash of that, and this is all good and fine, but when you don't have that service from a detox perspective that provides that, it ultimately ends up washing out in other areas. And I think our jails, and Jeff can say, knows this, that when those detoxes closed, we had more people
just who how it works.
Mental illness, chemical dependency issues who end up now in our jails that we're paying for in another area.
Mr. Johnson.
Yeah, well, serving on since 07 on the correction board, I know when the Crow Wing County closed their detention center, the sheriff's department was nervous. So, you know, like you said, they did a good job, and they have, because they didn't know what they were going to do. So
I think, Commissioner, just one of those systems that's felt the challenges with the closings of detox centers is our emergency rooms, our medical facilities. You know, I would have ventured to bet that if they were to graph out those individuals experiencing substance use issues, they would probably see an increase in the emergency rooms, in their clinics, trying to manage those individuals. So,
well, and Mr. Chair, this would also all relate to the closing of state hospitals, which is the same book, but maybe another page. Yeah.
That's another
all.
Page.
That's another book.
Yeah. That's
yeah. Anything else, gentlemen?
Another
thank
volume.
You,
nope.
Thanks,
that's all I have.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a
thank
good
you.
Day.
You bet.
Planning and zoning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Who is it you have with you, Amy?
I'd like to introduce you to our new feel-out officer. This is Brett Fellbaum.
And what was the last name?
Fellbaum.
Fellbaum.
Yep, from Swanville.
Okay. Just tell them who your parents are.
Yes,
they're all
going to
know.
Greg and Lydia are my parents.
Who's your county commissioner?
He knows, we talked about
yes. So this is our new face for feedlots. His first day was yesterday.
Welcome
aboard.
Welcome. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Exactly.
And he's training alongside Darren for the next 3 weeks.
Oh, that'll be good.
Nice. Yes. Wonderful. And so they'll be getting out in the field as soon as this afternoon.
Yep. Yep.
So, yeah.
Okay, so Darren's got another 3 weeks. He'll be around, and then he's gone.
He'll be here 2 days a week for the next 3 weeks.
Okay. Good.
And so, and then the timing was perfect because the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency is doing a new new feedlot officer training next week, so.
Oh,
perfect, perfect timing, so. I think we'll get them going pretty well, so.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I think we had about 14 applicants, and it was so fun to watch this. Amy was so excited. She said, there's somebody local, somebody who knows ag, somebody who's interested in coming to join our team, so we're glad to have you.
Somebody very young.
I'm just amazed. It's like, did you just get out of high school?
I looked like that once.
Yeah.
I think we all did.
I can't remember that.
But that's a good thing, remember that.
Yeah.
Yes, so you're gonna see him.
Good.
From now on, and so he's just gonna sit and observe while we go through the rest of our stuff to get a feel for what these.
Good enough.
Either like, so the one item I do have for you today is consideration of the interim use permit from Jerry, or I'm sorry, not Jerry Wenzel. that's a different Wenzel. for Anthony Wenzel. If you recall, this was considered by the Planning Commission, and this is a request for an interim use permit for a kennel. The Planning Commission did recommend approval with four conditions. The conditions are a dog shall be indoors between the hours of 6 p.m. and 8 a.m. This practice shall begin by November 1, 2016. The second one is outdoor exercise of the dog shall occur between the hours of 8 o'clock a.m. and 6 o'clock p.m. And this practice shall begin by November 1, 2016. Three, this interim use permit shall be valid for 5 years from the date of issuance. And four, the kennel operation shall be performed exclusively by Anthony Wenzel.
All right, gentlemen, we have this motion, or we need a motion to consider the after the fact for Anthony and Judith Wenzel.
So moved.
I have a motion.
Second.
I would second that.
I got a second. Any more discussion?
Mr. Chair, you know, I've met with Tony a couple times on this issue, and in reviewing through the Sheriff's Department and through Planning and Zoning, there's never been a complaint regarding this facility. So that being said, my concern is Tony's process or project, his dog, you know, raising dogs is monitored by the Minnesota Department of Animal Health, the American Kennel Association, and the county, okay? So we have a lot of oversight on this operation, all right? My concern is that the process, the very elongated process, and that, first of all, had to come for a variance, and then secondly, for a permit, conditional use permit. 5 years, I think, is way too short of a time, and I really believe, from my perception, that this, Tony is now, I believe, 74. This interim use permit should stay with Tony until he decides to discontinue it personally. Once he's done, he's done. I don't believe he should have to come back in and go through this whole process again in 5 years. That would be my addition to one of the conditions, or a change to that condition, to support.
Any more discussion, gentlemen?
Mr. Chair?
No.
I wonder if Miss Amy could tell us why we would have a date of 5 year limit on it. You can explain what the interim use.
Yes, that's a great question, please. Because this is a new permit that we haven't seen very often. But one of the requirements of an interim use permit is that the board does identify some sort of ending time, and that can be that can take the form of a few different things. It can be a number of years, it can be a date, it can be until a certain condition happens. So that's why you need to have something identified in this. And so that's why this was recommended by the Planning Commission, but you certainly have the ability to revisit
So if I may, to follow up with what Commissioner Maurer said, if you were to put a statement versus a date, and uses words of, Mr. Wenzel's gonna quit raising dogs on January 1st, whenever. I don't know that the date, as far as I'm concerned, is a concern for this second anyway. But he's gonna quit one day. And in all respect, he's 74, but he might raise dogs until he's 104. Good grief, he's a Wenzel. I don't know. I mean, he told me during all the meetings that he has a good business and he has good dogs. I don't know how long he's going to do that. So is the date the big deal, or would the I'm out of business be the same
no,
as?
No, another common type of condition would be until that individual no longer owns the property, until, you know, so yes, it can be a particular event, so until the property, the current property owner gives notice to the board, but I'm not sure if there needs to be, and I'll ask the county attorney that, if there needs to be more concrete and until he just no longer wants to do it. I don't know if it needs to be more concrete than that.
A little more concrete than that. Okay. Certainly, the ownership changing is a common clear end date.
Okay.
Or you could extend the 5 years to 10 years or 15 years. Or if you want to put it out there in the future. A lot longer, that's fine too.
Until the 18th full moon
of the second solstice.
Yes. Okay. That would be really easy to check.
Commissioner Johnson.
Did Kevin make the motion?
Yes.
Did I second it or?
I'm just on the original one right now with the motion and second was just on with the four conditions. But then again, that's why we're having discussion.
Okay. Well, I would like to see maybe what Brian just said, moving the five. You know, Commissioner Maurer said until he quits raising dogs or whatever, let's move it to 10. My suggestion.
And Mr. Chair, if I may, I know when in our development review team meeting with the applicant, we did discuss that because we made it clear that there needs to be an end date.
Yep.
And the 10-year time frame seemed to be more than reasonable for the applicant as far as what he had expected to be operating the kennel.
Well, Mr. Chair and members of the board, my only concern with that would be this, okay? I don't want his having to come back in 10 years and go through this process again, deterring him from doing it for one or two more years. That would be my concern. If that's going to be the reason for him to discontinue this in 10 years as opposed, so I would like, if we're going to do 15, fine. I mean, but or when he decides to change. I mean, why, if he's going to say, well, God, I'd like to do this another year or two, but I got to go in and go through that whole process again. Does that make sense? You know what I mean? So 15?
Yeah, the 10.
If I may speak, I don't believe we've done maybe, 10, 12 interims over the last 4 years.
Oh,
but anyway, every one of them had an end date, okay, that I can't recall that we had an open end date on them. Okay, there was a reason, and it was brought up that we have to have an end date. I was at the planning commission meeting, and it was agreed by the applicant that the 5 years was good enough. Now, again, Commissioner Maurer is bringing up the 10. Again, 5 or 10 years, but the longer we extend this out, in my opinion, it stays with that. Yeah, granted, it will disappear in 15 years or 10 years, but I don't think 10 years is the longest. Again, correct me if I'm wrong as far as interim goes. And there was a complaint. Commissioner Maurer said there was no complaint. Again, not under this board, not under yours, but we had a gentleman there that he said he did not like the noise. It was probably 10, 15 years, gave an explanation why he didn't like it. So there was one, and that was his next door neighbor who happens to be the closest to him. He's not here, obviously. So again, the recommendations by the Planning Commission is the 5 years. And again, I was stood there and it was brought up to the applicant and he was okay with that. So that's, I think my challenge is here is the outdoor exercise of the dogs. The applicant, there's north, south, east, west, side, whatever, I can't recall, that it should be only, and he has plenty of room, we discussed that takes the dogs out on the same side as where the homeowner is that on his property, and the applicant didn't quite like that, but yet he still has plenty of room on the other side. I would, if there's a give and take here, I'd prefer to, go to 10 years if that's the case, but I would like to see the dogs go on the other side.
Mr. Chair, the conditions right now was limiting the hours that the dogs are out.
Yeah.
Are you suggesting a condition to also indicate the location
exercise
of the exercising?
Right, exercise them on the opposite where he has plenty of land, and that was a big discussion, and I think that was passed, but again, mm-hmm. I'd have to look at the records on that one, but that's where I would like to...
Mr. Chair, I think the issue that was the chosen exercise area for the puppies.
Puppies, correct, yep.
So are you looking for a condition for where the exercise area
well,
of the
again,
puppies
here
is?
Well, again, it says dogs, you know, mm-hmm. again, I think that's kind of broad enough, you know, where you don't just say puppies, because I'm for, you know, having the adult dogs being exercised too, but mm-hmm. again, to keep them farther away, because he did get a variance mm-hmm. to get within so many feet of that other home, and I just feel that he could exercise them, all the dogs, whether it's the puppies or everything, on the opposite side of the building. That's what I'm proposing.
So if you recall where the exercise area is now for the adult dogs, are you wanting a change in area for the adult dogs, or just that all of the dogs need to be exercised?
Well, I can't,
in that area?
I can't remember that, Amy, where the adult dogs were, but yes, I know that the puppies were the
one. They were on the north side. So between the kennel facility and the neighbor, that's where the puppies are exercised.
Right, and that's right. And
the adult dogs are on the east side, right. Along the
which
side
which is
of
fine
building.
With me. Then like, okay. We can put the puppies, put them on the south side. Again,
Mr.
that's
Chairman.
My proposal.
Mr. Chair,
yes.
That would mean, and the issue, the reason the Planning Commission did not put that as one of the conditions is it would mean removing a whole bunch of big trees that are standing on that side of the building. So that would be the issue. Yep. There is a plenty open area on the west side of the building. There is a building between that area and the neighbor, Mr. Johnson. So I can't support that. I mean, I think it's kind of ridiculous from my perspective to have to move a bunch of big trees to be able to exercise the dogs on that south side of the building.
I disagree. Dogs can't exercise around trees? I don't know. Why would you have to remove the trees? I mean, that's my opinion.
It's very wooded.
Very wooded.
And very wooded.
Dogs go through woods, but that's my opinion.
Yep.
So.
Mr. Chair, I got one. I was out there last Friday and visited the site, and when I pulled in the yard, and I had my hearing aids in, so I could, there was no noise. There was no noise. There was no noise. And I was, Tony took me inside. Nice, clean operation. Really nice. So I support this with 10 or whatever we do, 15. I mean, just, you know, however we do this, so he doesn't have to come back again.
Commissioner Wilson.
Mr. Chair, just to put a little history on this, and correct me if I'm wrong, but Tony's done this over 20 years already?
Oh, more than
30,
that,
okay.
35.
And this permit came up because of some law changes in his licensing and so forth. And we're talking 6 pairs of dogs right now, I think, and it was up to
6
8.
Adult breeding dogs.
Yeah, so I mean, mm-hmm. that's what we're talking. We're talking 6 adult dogs here. We're talking the pups. I just want people to understand that this has been in operation for a long time. And the gentleman that was there, I felt he was here not necessarily complaining, in the sense he just wanted to make aware that the dogs did bark at sometimes, and he was worried about selling his property and stuff for new owners, and this was the time to address that. And there were some things in place, the regulations that you have there, that I think are adequate. And I would like to see this go out, if you want to say 15 years, just so we cover it. And Tony, don't come back in 15 years and ask for another 1 year. But I'm okay with that. That covers the years, if that's what it is. And we do. And please try to respect the neighbor, too, in his concerns. That's where I'm at.
Yep. Any more discussion, gentlemen? So, again, with the motion and the second, we are, and Amy, if you want to repeat that, are we looking at going 10 or 15 years that Commissioner Maurer is proposing?
My motion would be for 15.
All right.
And if I seconded, did I second it? Oh, Jeff
no,
did.
We didn't, yeah.
And if I seconded it, I would second that.
Okay, so you'll second that. Okay, any more discussion on the 15 years versus the 5 years for the conditions on the permit? All right, gentlemen, if that's the case, I need a motion, which I have, and I got a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Myself.
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I will get this changed and back up to you. The other thing I just want to show you is the new AIS t-shirts are here.
Ooh, look at that.
So we've got Water Festival coming up next week.
Okay.
And so these will be given out to our sixth graders again. So we'll have blue Good. AIS
these sixth
billboards.
Graders too get one?
Yeah. So All if you're right. interested in All one, right. come on down and we'll get you your t-shirt, especially if you're going to be at the Water Festival. Wear your t-shirt. I know the Soil and Water Conservation District will be in there. T-shirts. So come on down, you know, if you're interested sure. in one of those.
You know what's real funny is yesterday I was at a place and a bunch of boats were coming in to a place
mm-hmm.
that came from competition, and one of them that you would think would never have a weed on it was covered with weeds in
right?
the parking
right.
lot of an establishment.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I'm just thinking of going to another lake for competition and all these okay. weeds that he's got on his boat. And you would think that they, if anybody,
mm-hmm.
would be protecting that.
Be aware
they
of
had
that
already chair. Passed the cleaning off stage. They were
yeah, they were they were in the parking lot of an establishment where everything is going to
yes.
have an event this weekend. Mm-hmm. But whatever lake they go
wow.
into next is going to have all those
yeah.
weeds.
Yeah.
Just
crazy.
Information,
yes.
I guess.
Yes.
And it wasn't a weed. It was a
weeds.
Ton of weeds.
So. Yeah,
nice
so
shirts.
we're gonna be doing that education right. piece with our sixth graders again
right.
This year, and so stop down.
We'll
perfect.
See you there.
Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Thank
you.
Thank you, guys.
Mr. Chair, can we recess, please?
How about let's get through the information technology, Good. Then we'll.
All
how's
right.
that sound?
Right.
Come on up, Joe.
We're working
He's been Joseph.
Good
morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
Good morning.
Morning, Joe.
Good morning.
Morning.
Morning, Joe.
As we discussed earlier, this is I need a signature for the MNCCC Joint Powers Agreement.
And MNCCC stands for what?
The Minnesota Computer
County
Computer Cooperative. You had asked for some information on how the fees have been split out. I do have that if you're interested.
We talked a little bit about the fact that there's a general membership to MCCC and that cost, but then any area that participates in software or has that software, the
mm-hmm.
maintenance agreements and things, that was kind of the question above and beyond what we were talking
yes.
about. And so Joe has that information for you. Oh, here, I can hand him off, Joe.
Okay.
You want to?
Short.
Why don't we hand those out here?
Those are the fees.
There's two more there. We got plenty of
The agreement from the co-op is basically that.
Does Brian want?
Thank you.
No.
Yeah.
Oh, Brian doesn't care.
There's a cap at $8,000 total for a county, regardless of how many of the different groups that we belong to, and we take advantage of that pretty extensively. I think we belong to almost all of their groups.
Mr. Chair, and if Joe, if you would explain to us just in short form, a couple sentences, being a part of this allows us as a consortium of what, 84 of the 87 or 83 of the 87 counties?
It depends on which group.
Which ones we're
yes.
in to mm-hmm. be able to purchase things at a bunch together, which results in us having less expense.
Correct. Yep.
Very good. That's
all
I wanted to clarify.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
This is an annual thing. We've done this.
Yep.
The
yep.
changes
yep.
are coming
yep.
about
yep.
primarily because of that name change. But
yeah,
then
yeah,
in addition
change.
To that,
yeah.
anytime you change an agreement like this, you go through and fine-tune anything else that
Gentlemen,
maybe needs to
I need
be
a
to
motion
so
to authorize. Got a motion to authorize the Minnesota CCC Joint Powers Agreement. I need a second.
I'll second it.
I got a second. Any more discussion?
Mr. Chair, I was the $6,000 question, I believe, during our planning session. And the answer that was given is exactly what I was looking for. We pay $6,000 to be members of this, but we absolutely reap benefits, if you will, by
tremendous.
Spending that $6,000. We reap well over that $6,000. It's worth our while.
Tremendously.
So that's,
yes.
I very much appreciate that.
Any more discussion, gentlemen?
I had somebody bring to my attention that why do we spend the $6,000? And I addressed to you like our expense would be, if we didn't belong to this organization, our expense would be a lot higher. than what the $6,000 is.
We wouldn't get that bulk buying ability, so to speak.
And we wouldn't have the input to how the software changes our things and that.
Exactly, which that value is intangible, but.
And we discussed that quite thoroughly.
We beat it up to death, yeah.
We beat it to death.
He happened to bring up something that was mentioned in the paper, I think, about the gal from California talking and thinking that that money was like for that, but that isn't really. He went to a convention and they brought in those types of speakers. It had nothing to do with a person from California coming to talk for $6,000.
No.
That's kind of the way I think he took that.
Okay.
So, okay.
Any more discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Pretty simple.
Thanks, John.
Now we can take five or seven.
Mr. Chair, can I make a request when we reconvene? Can we, there's an extra group under mine if we could pull that ahead of schedule, that would be great. No, it's, yeah, that we can reconvene, there's an emergency declaration that we've had to do that.
We'll do that.
All right. And then record, I'm not sure.
You'll like, they did a good job. See, I missed the last meeting.
Sure.
We have a lot of us, for the counties, we have a lot of the Sept people.
Yeah, I know. Yep.
What are we waiting for?
I'm not, I'm just sitting there talking, he's drilling, he's making my mind think here.
Well, hey, it's good with me.
Which is, okay.
And once we got it going, you don't wanna stop.
Yeah, now I can't stop.
Well, there we go.
Yeah, whatever, we'll come back to it. Okay, we've got that one, let's go on to the, let's, Camp Ripley.
We're gonna reschedule things a bit.
Yep.
Thank you for your flexibility.
Absolutely.
We never know for certain how long they're going to take to ask the question.
Morning.
Morning.
Gentlemen, ladies.
Morning.
And if you can, please state your names for the record.
Pat Boone, Camp Ripley Fire Chief and Emergency Manager.
Victoria Ingram, Emergency Manager and Communications Supervisor for Morrison County.
Good morning.
Mr. Chair, this is in your board packet, the revised board packet, way down in the administrator's report, but their copy's being handed out with the declaration.
So this is the same, am I right?
Yes.
Go ahead.
I am here today on behalf of Morrison County and Camp Ripley. We are requesting a state of emergency to be declared for Morrison County due to damages received from the tornado on September 7th.
All right, gentlemen, I need a.
I would so move.
I have a motion to declare a state of emergency in Morrison County. Got a motion and a second? All right, any more discussion? Well, if not.
Well, Mr. Chair, the discussion's gonna be what took place.
Well, but again.
Something happened. What are we doing this for? And that is because of the tornado and the storm that went through Green Prairie and Camp Ripley. Maybe even a little into, I think, Ripley Township.
Correct, so Morrison County is completing the state of emergency due to damages from the September 7th tornado that went through northern Morrison County affecting Camp Ripley, Darling, Green Prairie and Ripley Townships. We're urged to complete the state of emergency to allow for emergency protective measures such as road closures and debris clearance. This also allows for the county to request state assistance. At this point, Morrison County Emergency Management and Camp Ripley staffs are working together to determine the related cost of the tornado. So yes, the tornado went through Camp Ripley, Darling, Green Prairie, and Ripley Townships.
According to the photos, they did a little damage out there too.
They did, they did.
Yeah, we took probably the
brunt of the storm.
How about
the solar panels? Did they get damaged?
Yep.
25 rows are damaged, so they figure 3 to 5% of the solar array has been suffered damages.
I was talking to somebody and I saw it on TV that stuff blew on them. Is that right?
Correct.
Stuff from elsewhere blew.
Yeah.
And I heard there was really no warning on this one. Was there?
Correct. We did not receive any warnings from the National Weather Service.
Right.
So according to the National Weather Service, it was a storm that rapidly intensified, which produced the EF1 tornado.
At about 10 o'clock?
10:34, I believe, is when it was reported as far as touching down.
Mr. Chair, as you recall, we kind of recently did this, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Victoria's
from July
been quite
11.
Busy. Yeah. But this starts that process in motion about accessing funds. It's a little unique. We haven't exactly had the Camp Ripley scenario, the state lands, the federal influence, all of that stuff happening with the facility. But we're learning as we go here, and I appreciate the effort that's been put forward between both Camp Ripley and Victoria to try to manage this. But this is the process that starts, or this is that initial need to access funds moving forward.
Mr. Chair, do either of you, if you will, have a rough ballpark?
I do. I can tell you today that right now damages are being reported around $30 million.
Wow. And again, this is a shotgun blast.
Oh, no, that's all I'm looking for.
The initial damage assessment.
It will get reassessed as we
could be 20 million, could be 50 million.
Correct. So with the initial damage assessment, it's kind of based on just ballpark figures. The solar array, they're figuring it's anywhere from 3 to 5% of the solar array being damaged. So at that, they determine $2 to $5 million, and then based on as far as the amount of building, structural damage, debris clearance, overturned trees,
and that's
that sort
just
of
not
thing.
In Camp Ripley, that's the whole thing.
Correct. So most of the damage is being reported for Camp Ripley. Right. In the townships, talking to the supervisors, most of the damage incurred there was private property. So.
So to go just a little bit further on the solar, and I don't know that either of you can answer this. Did the solar itself, the panels, did they withstand everything, and was it just debris that caused the damage, or don't you know that?
Based on the assessments that were made, it was both. There was debris that caused structural damage, as well as the tornado itself uplifting panels.
They were throwing debris into the field, but there were some panels that were peeled off of the stands that they're working on.
Okay, very good.
So, Mr. Chair. As a military base, and just curiosity, do they start cleaning that up themselves
instantly? We were doing debris removal at 11 o'clock that night, 11:30. We had staff in that were starting to clear trees, clear roadways, and then we proceeded to continue that debris removal to open all the roadways up. We had rows of buildings that were off, and we continued to remove that stuff so we can continue the function.
And in 2 weeks, those roofs are going to all be back on again.
Not 2 weeks. Probably not. 2 years, maybe.
Are you insured, like, with buildings?
You know, I have no idea. This is really...
Yep, so once...
This is a whole new area that we're dealing with.
Someone asked me that. I said, yeah, we insure them.
Yeah, well, I believe that.
The people.
I don't know what the process is.
Right. Someone's going to pay for it.
That's a great question in terms of what this all means. And that's been a question that was instantly raised, where whose jurisdiction, who needs to start this process? Is it the county? Is it not the county? And we've kind of worked through this as we've gone. And Victoria has led that charge. I mean, she can tell you more, probably.
So once we do the initial damage assessment, we're going to send our report. Based on the information that we put together, we send that to the Minnesota Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Management. Then from there, their staff are going to work together to start parsing all the information out, because based on as far as your damage assessments, it gets put into categories as far as with debris removal, any kind of structural damage and so forth, and then start working through that process, and then they'll guide us further on what we need to do, but they'll be the ones that will start helping to answer those questions on who's going to be responsible, ultimately what is going to be the dollar amount and so forth. So
it's really no different than any of the roads that have been destroyed in flooding, only we've got a whole bunch of more parts
that go with it.
Just more stuff.
Yep.
So at this time, we're being advised that we need to start this process at the county level. So that's why
you're telling us that we're off task.
No, not at all. I would never do such a thing.
You're right. Any more discussion, gentlemen? If not, I have a motion and a second. Those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thanks for your effort.
Thank you both very much.
Okay. Thank you.
We got a long ways to go.
Okay.
This is the start.
All right.
Thank you.
Be cool.
Assessor's report. Going right along.
Morning, Glenn.
Good morning, Gordon.
Good morning, Glenn.
You don't appraise the properties out of Camp Ripley, do you?
Sure do.
Oh, just to say they're exempt?
Once every 6 years, we pick up exempt properties across the entire county.
Oh.
And this is the sixth year.
Well, isn't life just interesting?
Yeah. is.
And how are we privileged with you this morning?
And it is a privilege, Glenn. Don't let them kid you here. It is a privilege.
Oh, it's getting deep here. Let's see. This morning I have two abatement applications to bring before you. One is concerning a mobile home that should be removed from the tax rolls. It's on wheels and hasn't been lived in since 2014. The second is concerning a property that had classified it as non-homestead in air. It should be classified as homestead. So,
can we do these both at the same time, or should we do them separately?
Yep.
I would so move on both of them.
All right, I got a motion and a second. Any more discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. That was it?
That's it?
Thank you.
Glenn, come on.
Glenn, thank you. Do you have anything else that you could maybe enlighten us on?
Do you have a new hire yet?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
There we go.
Right. I certainly do, and that new hire will start Monday morning at 8 o'clock. So now we are.
And you have a lot of applicants that we have?
A little, not a lot. But all you need is one good one. That's so right. We are lucky in that regard. Yes.
There we go.
All you need is the best one.
Yes, yep. We have a gentleman from Little Falls who I think is going to be a good addition to Morrison County and committed to the organization. So
that's about that. We only need one.
Yep, exactly.
It's all it takes.
Does the board have anything for me?
Other than keep smiling.
Have a wonderful day.
Yeah, you guys too.
Thanks, Glenn.
Are we going to do an auditor's report again?
Yep, one is done.
Well, we already did one already, so this has got to be the looking for hitch and rail or whatever.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, we have a request from the Big Lake Sportsman Club to hold a raffle at Stonehill Bar and Grill on November 26th.
Second.
Right. I got a motion and a second. Any more discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
And we also have warrants.
All right. Motion to pay the bills. This will be a roll call. All of them.
And a second.
I got a motion and a second. Are you keeping up there?
Mm-hmm.
All right. This is a roll call vote. Commissioner Wilson.
Aye.
Commissioner Maurer.
Aye.
Commissioner Jelinski.
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson.
Aye.
Myself, aye. Motion carried.
Thank you, gentlemen.
All right. Okay.
Thanks, Dad.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
Mr. Chair, the cash report's included just for your information.
Yes.
Yep. Yes, all.
All.
And you did sign my mileage, Commissioner?
Not yet.
He threatened not to.
You signed mileage.
No, definitely not
yet. That's what I'm wondering.
Where are we going from here?
Steve Bukowski.
Steve. Mr. Bukowski's.
Steve, all the problems must have been left for you today.
I'm beginning to think somebody put something in the water.
Oh, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, it's great to see you. And we have one action item for your consideration.
Let's see where we are.
Over the past number of years, the county board has demonstrated their support for the Veterans State Trail and the work that's being conducted by the Veterans State Trail Committee, private committee working on getting this trail alignment established and eventually built. It has been designated and is a state trail, and so the DNR is the lead agency and what's happening with it. We have been providing support to the DNR as this has started to proceed and determinations and potential alignments are being considered. We haven't spent a lot of time, but now as things are starting to focus into certain areas and more detailed work needs to be conducted in order to determine rights of way where the alignment may eventually fall. The DNR has asked that the Public Works Department would provide engineering assistance to them as they work that through. Up to this point in time, we have provided information that they requested and we just did that as a part of our normal operations. Under this agreement though, if there is activities that the department would do in support of moving this trail forward and a decision made on where the alignment may go, right away acquisition, eventually to construction, we would be compensated for the work that we would provide in assisting the DNR to do that. And so that's what this agreement represents. It has been reviewed by the county attorney and he has no objections. And so our request would be to authorize the chairman and the administrator to enter or sign the agreement that you would agree to enter into.
Okay, gentlemen, I need a motion for discussion to authorize the signing of the cooperative agreement between Minnesota DNR and Morrison County for veterans.
I'll move on this, Mr. Chair.
Motion, and I need a second, please.
Second.
Got a second? Any more discussion?
Mr. Chair, in reality, our engineer and our county staff have been providing assistance with this throughout the process. Now this just is that we can bill for it out of the fund that was created and is sitting there for this project, so.
If I may, Steve, does this have anything to do with the ATV trail too? Yes, no?
They both are included in this.
Because I talked to the DNR last night about the ATV versus the other trail. They want to put one on the east and the ATV on the east and the other trail on the west. And it's a pretty good thing because they said they'll be the first state trail for an ATV in Minnesota. You know, so I just throw
that section
out.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, so that'll be something.
Yeah, the multimodal aspect of it is a unique thing that's just with this trail.
You know, Mr. Chair, I have no idea when this is ever going to become a reality, if it's ever going to become a reality, but I know that there's a lot of people, a lot of private people that have put a lot of time and meet on a routine basis in regards to the trail. And they're meeting in regards to walking, biking, snowmobiling, and certainly four-wheeling through the whole thing. It's not just, there's a select few. I mean, it's open to anybody and their brother to do this, but you know, we've gone through a few years that we really haven't had a great deal of snow. So there's a lot of snowmobiles, I'm sure, that are in sheds. And we've talked at this board, as far as four-wheelers, or ATVs, excuse me, are concerned, there's a lot of them out there. And I think there's getting to be more and more and more. So there's a lot of support, I believe, out there for trails, for trail riding.
Steve, if I may, for the engineering part, would you help out the townships too? Because they're going to need something, obviously, some help there too, through the DNR or whatever. Would that be part of this?
You know, if there is any involvement from the townships and the city would be involved, the city of Little Falls, they'll be brought into that. I think the DNR will be who leads that right. And when that has to occur. But certainly, we will be there and take into consideration their aspect of it from the same perspective as we will with the county, such as township road intersections, right. How that trail may cross, those type of things will be issues that will have to be worked through with them.
In my opinion, that ATV trail is going to be closer than the walk and ride or drive. I think the ATV will come along a lot quicker because, again, they don't have as much. They're going to use township roads. They'll use county roads where they're on the west side is going to be private citizens that they're going to have to more deal with. So.
It's anyway, it's a slow, meticulous process definitely. Because just one individual, one property owner that you may need to deal with can stop it.
Yeah.
And so it's a big, big project that you go a long way with before you really know that might happen.
And they indicated to me that they would not use eminent domain if a property owner says no, that's where it stops.
Yeah. Well, so, and Mr. Chair, the unique thing about that in the last 3.5-4 years that Commissioners Randy and I and Jeff have been on this and I've been going to these trails meetings, the really unique part of that is through that process we have gotten that broken down to really focus on sections instead of this big thing where they wanted everything done and it was so insurmountable. Now it's much more focused and that's what's happened in the last several years, which is a good thing because we're taking in bits and pieces and that's the way these things need to get done. That's the good thing.
4 years ago it was the elephant.
Oh, yeah.
And now today it's pieces as it should be. I mean, you can't build it as the elephant. You
have to build the foundation first.
As the foundation, sure, piece by piece.
Sure,
so,
which is good.
All right, gentlemen. Any more discussion? If not, those in favor.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Motion carried.
Otherwise, we're just continuing with normal operations out of Public Works. We've got we'll be finishing up the project on County State 823, the bridge replacement.
Is that close to soon?
Yeah, the structure's in. It's being backfilled. Let's see, probably tomorrow they'll be paving back the section that was open. And then we've got a lot of the finishing work and turf reestablishment. And then the final lift will be bituminous will go down on Friday. So we should be out of there by the end of this week. MnDOT then is going to be firing up their project here at Rice Creek, east of Little Falls. That's supposed to, the detour go on next Monday. And following that, then our project down on County Road 244 that is under contract with the same contractor doing the state work, we'll move down there and finish off what we have under contract. Our maintenance guys, we've got some, we're out shouldering. Most of that is going on out east right now. We've got some of the final mowing taking place. Then we'll move into work with our brush hogs. It's going to be kind of a slower season with brush hog just because things are so wet. We're not going to be able to get down into areas that we'd like to this year, it's looking like, until freeze up, unless it freezes up.
Mr. Chair, and I think it's in, is it in Jess District, the old Gravelville Bridge? We had talked about that. We're under
agreement with Belle Prairie Township.
Well, you're talking about King Road.
King Road, okay. Yes. And we've conducted the survey. We'll be doing the design. It'll be a project that'll take place next year.
That's gone to public hearing.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Just,
okay, so it's moving along.
Steve, do you have any updates on 27? That bridge still isn't open.
What I had heard early this week was that paving probably was done, if not yesterday, today. Guardrail is going in, and okay, they won't open. They won't pull the detour until the guardrail is in place. So I'd expect that the guardrail was supposed to start today. Probably a couple days. By the end of the week, that should be pulled off.
I just noticed I drove there last night, and you could drive through there on that, but now it's closed off completely again. Okay. So maybe they're doing the guardrails.
So you went around the detour, you tell them?
No. It said local traffic.
Steve, just local. One quick question. Did you get involved at all with this latest tornado business that up in Darling Green Prairie?
We didn't really have anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I assume we have a meeting Monday morning? Still on?
Yes, we do.
Yep.
Yes.
8:30, I think. Right? Yep.
All right.
We're talking about on the 19th.
26th. Oh, no.
The 26th. Is
26. Yeah.
It's
2 weeks. Excuse me. 2 weeks.
Yeah. Yesterday.
Yeah. That's right.
I better get back. Get ready for it.
You're double.
Steve,
if 1:30
on the 20th would work for you?
Okay.
You, if it would work. That's the day of our board meeting, and I got time in between some stuff.
On the 20th?
You can text me.
You know, yeah, something you can talk to him at.
It will work. Okay. I'll put it in.
I don't have to talk any further about that.
That's
the
all I have,
Mr. Later.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
Thanks, Steve.
Thanks, Steve.
Have a good day.
If you abuse me a little bit, you feel better. That way.
Well, we should talk a little slower because we're so ahead of schedule.
Yeah, that's
right
fine.
Now.
I can eat lunch. And
don't worry, you'll figure that out.
Administration report.
All right, Mr. Chair, I have one action item that I need consideration on, to appoint Commissioner Johnson and Commissioner Wilson and Nicole Kern as the MACCAC delegates for Community Corrections and Community Corrections Association of something. I don't know all that. We talked about it at a planning session. I don't know if, Duane, do you remember what that MACAC is, what the acronym is? Because I can't.
I don't remember it all.
But it's the Community Corrections Association, in which we're a member of, and so
all right,
officially appointing delegates.
We need a motion to appoint Duane and Mike and Nicole to the MACCAC delegate community. I'll
so
make
I'll
that move. Motion.
I'll second.
All right. Any discussion? If not, those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried.
All right, and I have just a few updates for you. First, the craft fair has come and gone and was successful. We're going to work with the chamber again to remind them to make sure that they sweep the parking lot. That's been an agreement, but it's been missed prior to employees coming, just to make sure that there aren't any nails or screws and things like that. So we need to remind the chamber to
and
make sure that's
Deb, done. Since she's here, you don't have to come up, but you said that was very successful with the downtown businesses with the arts and craft.
With the shops of Little Falls, they made more than $10,000 our first day, so they did a very good job.
Yep. That's very good. Good to hear.
For like what? Like parking. Parking. Oh. Or what?
The downtown shops, they have like 20
businesses
make 10,000
in parking.
In
first
oh, I thought you were talking about parking.
Open
business?
Oh,
I see.
Thielen Appliance.
Okay.
Yep.
That's,
yeah. They have all those little shops in there.
Yes.
Okay.
So those places made more than $10,000. And the parking, Kiwanis made more than $6,000 their first day in parking.
Yeah.
In the other
and I know Chris, she's a big pusher behind
she
that.
She is.
You know,
Chris
Bomberg. She's the one who wanted you to paint the chairs, remember?
Yes.
Yeah. Did you pay one, Commissioner?
Yep, I did.
I'm glad for it.
Is she talking to us?
Okay, moving on.
And then, so that went, came and gone. It's always a fun day at the office and getting folks in set up at the end of the day on the Friday before craft fair. As you can see, the parking lot construction is coming along. I anticipate that to be done quite soon. I think they're done with the curbing and everything, and that pavement should be going.
That holding pond, is that one right in the corner there?
And in the way long back, there's a long one in the back next to the library, and one in the front. Just if you look at how cool that is.
Yep.
Just like that.
Everything goes right to those two retention ponds.
Mosquitoes on both sides.
There you go. It isn't gonna go into our river, so that's the good thing. Really neat stuff.
And I think if you look at that, that library is a beautiful building. It really is. It cleans up that corner. I think it's a very aesthetically pleasing result. Let's put it that way. So that is coming along. You may have saw an email. I'm gonna hold some employee meetings. I've had some questions. I've been able to touch certain employee groups, present to them on updates of kind of insurance philosophical approaches that we've discussed before with the bargaining units, wanting to make sure everybody's on the same page with those. With the facilities discussion and upcoming maintenance issues and things of that nature, and also parking and giving employees an update on that, because there will be parking in which we will then designate for visitor parking, expanding that opportunity for visitor parking. And that's something we can talk about if you want input on that, but John and I were discussing probably looking at more just visitor parking, not so much time limit parking, because it seems as if some folks are here for quick little transactions, and some are here for a number of hours. And so I'm just identifying more visitor parking in general.
If I may, Deb, I'm drawing a blank. The lines across 27, are they pretty for crosswalk? Are they very visible now, or are they kind of faded out?
Sharon, I think we've had some discussion about that and they've removed some of the parking out there already, but even moving that parking back so that, because when people are walking out between cars, it's hard to see them coming out. But we may at some point need to look at talking to Steve about the highway department, putting a flashing light there or something.
That is a state highway.
That's a state highway.
Steve talking to the state about...
Well, Greg Kimmon, it's a city, Little Falls. And so I'm working with them. They did come out and they did get approval to increase that no parking. I agree with you there. I know there's a little guy with the crosswalk sign thing right there to help with that too. But I think further discussions will be had. They're going to look at that and see how that progresses.
You know, moving cars back, and I talked to Greg Zilka, and they're thinking of having the police department keep an eye on it, because people fly through there too. I just last week I was out there, and I was standing out there where you could see me. No cars were blocking, and there were quite a few that it took a while.
We all need a reminder to stop for those pedestrians.
Maybe they knew me, but whatever. So they kept going.
So we'll continue to work on that, and I think there's going to be that'll evolve as we see how things progress. Yeah. So, but anyway, that's
anything else.
Right at this time, is anybody waiting on anything for me or have anything?
Yeah, Victoria. Okay, if we want, we can do our planners, but we had an issue with the planning session.
If you wanted to, I know, Commissioner Winter, you were discussing the fact that the water festival and the event for those bright blue shirts that Amy showed us is next week, and one of the mornings is Tuesday. It's Tuesday and Wednesday, the 20th and 21st. Did you want to look at the start time of that planning session?
So I don't know if any of you guys are going
to
be...
I was going to go to the water festival. Because we do have the... Start at
8:45.
Yeah. So it conflicts a little bit. If we start the meeting at 9:30 or something, I don't care. I just thought I'd throw that out there if you'd like.
Tim? It starts at 8:45. It's
We got community development afterwards. That worked perfect for us.
So can we do 10 o'clock on Tuesday? Would that work, Randy?
I'm open. I just brought it up, so I'd be fine.
Yeah. Would that? Can we switch the?
So we'll change the start time to 10 o'clock instead of 8:30.
That'd be good.
10 o'clock, and on Tuesday, am I right? It is the Little Falls Schools Tuesday, and Wednesday it's out of Little Falls.
Typically, that's the case.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
All right, so we'll change that to 10.
And then Wednesday, that's also 8:45 both days.
We can't change that, so they'll be both days on 8:45 at Camp Ripley for the water festival. So, all right, so we got that taken care of. So let's start with the reports here. Let's start with Commissioner Johnson.
What are we talking, 19th through August, or October 1st?
Yes.
On Tuesday the 20th, the planning at 10, Water Festival, and Commissioner Wilson and I have community development at 1215 Pine Country, Water Festival 845, the 21st, and on the 21st, Commissioner Wilson and I will be at Grandview Lodge for the MACAC for corrections. And I don't even know the time on it right now. I think it's an evening, like 6 o'clock. I can find out from Nicole, or Nicole would know.
Well, Tabitha can talk to Nicole.
I think
talk
I may
to
have Nicole.
Oh, you may have been copied on that.
Okay.
Yes,
I think
actually.
It's in the evening though.
Yep.
Yeah, like 6. And then that MACAC goes Thursday and Friday, the 22nd and 3rd. I have Region 5. 22nd at 6 o'clock in Staples. 26th, we have planning and zoning at 7 in the evening, and public works at 8:30 in the morning. We have board on 27th. Commissioner Wilson and I think that's at Breezy Point. The 28th, 29th, and 30th is a public health conference.
Breezy
and
Point.
I think it's in Breezy Point, but I'm not positive.
I think that maybe is the one that I'm...
Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, yeah. Katie would know all that. No?
June 30th, yeah.
No?
First.
And Given Blood on the 27th of September at the courthouse here.
Okay.
That's it. That's all I have.
Commissioner Wilson.
I
19th through the 30th.
He's, Dwayne did all of mine, except I've got something here, Board of Director Orientation, Little Falls Conference Room, on Saturday. I don't, it come through.
The 24th, you talk?
Yeah, the 24th. Does anybody have anything like that?
24th?
Board of Directors.
Well, I don't know, it says to accept it, you know.
Board of Directors from who?
Well, he's got somebody okay. Emailed him to accept the time.
Yeah, who's
yeah.
The email from?
I'll have to.
Who's it from? Does it say who's it from?
No, it's. Oh, this is Jennifer Lopez. No, this,
oh, this is
TCC.
TCC, yeah. Okay, so that would be one.
The TCC Board of Director
okay,
Orientation.
Yeah,
there we go.
Well, yeah, I didn't know either.
So now you can put that down as you may or may not be attending, but that's okay. One of them.
What
okay,
time was that?
9 o'clock.
On Saturday.
Yeah. Saturday the 24th. Otherwise, all of mine have been touched on.
You said that was here, right?
Did you say that was meeting room one?
No,
it was Little Falls School.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, Commissioner Maurer.
On the 19th, there's a I wrote this in here, but I don't know for sure, but it's prescription drug form on the 19th, I believe. I don't know if that's at the high school, but anyways. And then...
I bet it's at the hospital.
Just
put a question mark where it's.
Yeah, and then let's see here.
Publish it like that. We're not sure where he's going to be.
He's going to be some
correction.
Works.
Stand up for you on the 26th at 5 o'clock at the middle school.
That won't be happening.
Isn't it?
No, I just got an email. It's either going to be the 27th or 28th at the middle school.
You're right on top of that stuff, Commissioner. Okay.
But I don't know when it. I don't know either.
Okay, we'll figure it out. All right.
They haven't decided.
And an HRA on the 27th at 7:30 in the morning. And that should be it.
Got him. Okay, Commissioner Jelinski.
On the 19th at 9 o'clock in the morning, I'll be in St. Cloud at an Armor Executive Committee meeting. And that's a special meeting for, don't ask me even what they're having, for executives. On that same day, and I doubt that I will be attending either one of these, but I think it's noteworthy, at 7 o'clock, there's an EMS Joint Powers Board meeting, Advisory Committee meeting. That's at the Stearns County Service Center. And at 7 o'clock that same evening, the Historical Society is having their annual meeting, and that's at the Charles D. Martin Auditorium, where the cousin of Commissioner Maurer will be speaking.
His cousinship of Commissioner Maurer? What's
on
the
his.
No, Brian Kobilka.
Kobilka, the Nobel Prize winner.
Yeah, we'll be talking on G. Cell couplers and his Nobel Prize.
And okay, we talked about planning, we talked about the water festival. On the 21st at 5 o'clock in the evening, I'll have a Hands of Hope meeting in meeting room 2. On the 22nd at 12:30, I'll be involved in a state emergency communications board meeting in Arden Hills. That's an Armor meeting. Be live and in concert Friday at Herbie's Bar.
We got to put that down.
When is that?
23rd.
23rd, you're live and
you
in
know
concert.
What? I don't think nobody knows where Herbie's Bar is.
Sobieski, beautiful. So
I remember everybody
knows that really that doesn't
many,
go down
many
there.
Many years ago.
That really doesn't
so
go
what
down
what time
there.
Is it at, Jeff?
It's not putting day. A bar down. It's just the
yeah. 23rd. Public Works, as Commissioner Mowers said, Stand Up For You on the 26th isn't happening, but it will be happening on the 27th or 28th, I'm not sure. Going board. Farm Family of the Year is also going to be in conjunction with the county board meeting on the 27th, and we're also going to have a 4-H breakfast.
We gotta pick up our shirts, remember.
I think that starts at 8:30 in the morning on the 27th. Yep. Are we supposed to do that?
For
no.
My bicep.
I never got a call.
They'll give it to us.
Yeah,
you're supposed to give me your size.
I did that.
Oh. A feeble attempt at humor, I'm assured, right?
On the 27th, on the 28th at 11 o'clock in the morning, I'll be in St. Cloud in an executive committee meeting. And at 1 o'clock, the Emergency Services Board meets. And I just said St. Cloud, and that's wrong. It's going to be at the summit for the central region.
For which
region.
One, the 11 or
both
the 1?
Both of them.
Summit.
Will
what's
be
the summit?
Held in conjunction with the Armor Summit, which is held in Alexandria. Remember, Tabitha, you got all that stuff sent to you, and you.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't matter.
Yep. Nope, I have that email.
On the 30th, at 10 o'clock in the morning, 11. EMS, Joint Powers Board meeting, and that will be at the Stearns County Service Center. And on the 1st, it'll be my 34th wedding anniversary.
Whoa.
Want to put that one down?
That's getting personal.
Y'all need to know that stuff.
Yes, I do.
Because I got it written down. Okay, I'm done.
All right.
That's it.
For myself, on the 22nd, Soil and Water, 9 o'clock. And if you guys all want to know, they were good to go. But on the 30th, Friday, I'll be out with some more teachers at a cabin up north.
So. All right. Good for you.
That's it. Any other things?
I would so move for adjournment.
I got a motion from Commissioner Johnson. I need a second. I got a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries, and we are adjourned at 11:14. Now we do have a budget again at 1, correct?
That's the correction that... That